Happy Sabbath. I know it's end of the week and summer time. You must be busy. Some of you looking a little tired, but Sabbath is special. Can I see the smiles? Happy Sabbath. Oh, that sounds better. Do you realize that in every empty seat here, the angels are sitting and willing to participate in our worship? We thank God for the Sabbath. Friday evening is a very special time to spend with our Lord, to reconcile, to worship, to meditate. It's a very special time. This evening I want to thank the ladies, all the secretaries who taken time in the committee time to prepare a song and sing in magnifying the Lord Jesus. I sincerely want to thank the pastor for, in the mid-year committees and in the year-end committees, when we ask him for a weekend, he happily allots the elders and the church board members. We appreciate them for keeping in mind the pressures that we have and helping out in accommodating us in the middle of the year, in the month of May, and in the end of the year, in the November, when we have our major committees. We invite the committee members who are seated here from Nepal, from Delhi, and many other important guests. You're very special. Thank you for worshiping today with us and Northeast too. I notice we have some empty benches because of the choir members. They're worshiping in Port Blair Church. And we praise God for these young people who went to witness there in that islands. May the Lord keep them safe and their ministry be fruitful. Ministry be fruitful. I also prayed during the week for the young people who are waiting for the results and the young people who are thinking of future plans to go to college and many other things. Dear young people in the church, you are very special to us. And we are praying for you. You are most important group in the church, and may we wish you good future as you make decisions basing in yourself in the Lord. This evening I prepared a simple message and I hope it will be a blessing to each one of us. And I prayed that this message will teach us something serious, something important that we need to know today. Can we ask the blessing of the Lord once again? Dear Lord, as you open the scriptures, we ask that you will open our hearts. And may not me, but the Holy Spirit be our teacher. At the end, may we learn something deeper, something serious, something very special about you. In Jesus' precious name we pray. When I read Gandhian chapter, Matthew 5, the first sermon on the mountain, Jesus was explaining the principles of heaven. He was trying to explain why he came to this earth and what his purpose exactly was. He started so beautifully. Multitudes came. Politicians came, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Zealots, and many other kinds of Jewish people came. The poor people came, the Romans. They were excited. They want to know what this 30-year-old young man was about to say. Everybody is attracted by his words. Everybody was, they were very connected kind of, want to know what this is about. So in their excitement, maybe some were came there expecting that he will put down the open strategy to how to destroy the Romans so that all the Jewish community can take over. But in that mixed feelings of great expectations, Jesus opened his mouth. Seeing the multitudes, he went up to the mountain and he set up, his disciples came to him and he opened his mouth for saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." And he tells what kind of blessings you will receive. The Christian basic principles, the character, the lifestyle that you can. And down the line, you will see as you read that scripture, 9th verse, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." I am really happy about that, that we should be the ambassadors of peace. Then later, 10th verse, it says, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for this is the kingdom of heaven. Kingdom of heaven is the secret thing. People are expecting to go to that kingdom of heaven. They want eternal home. They want the solution to their sin predicament and all the problems. But here he gives the secret. The secret is, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake. For what sake? For righteousness' sake. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Dear brothers and sisters, this evening I want to speak about most important topic that is not very comfortable to us. Adventists are at times, they expressed, they are not comfortable when we talk about judgment and when we talk about uneasy subject like persecution and suffering. Because we are like to be comfortable in the comfortable zone. We do not like to be disturbed. We want certain pattern, certain way of thinking, certain way of doing. We do not want to be disturbed. But the secret is, if you want to become the citizen of the heavenly home, the secret is, the agenda is, the strategy is, that if you live a righteous life, you may be persecuted. Persecution and suffering in something, people do not like it at all. They do not like it. And he explains these verses in 2-3 ways. And 11th verse says, blessed are thee when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Verse 12, rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Why did God spend 3 verses explaining about it? Because it is connected with your heavenly home. Because it is connected with your heavenly destiny. It is important that we understand the topic called persecution and suffering. Christians become very discomfortable because when they do not like the word, even the word suffering and persecution. Persecution in the early Christian church began with the stoning of Stephen, the first martyr of the Christian church. When they stoned Stephen, people were terrorized. They were filled with fear. As a result, the church scattered all around Palestine. They even crossed the boundaries of the Roman reign. The stoning of Stephen has become something very unique. Since then, the Christian historian writes, 40 million believers were killed for the sake of Christ. And out of that, 26.6 are in our century. Talk about the Chinese, what you call communism and all those things. 26.6 million are in our century. John Grace, the religious liberty leader, retired, but General Conference leader, says, there are 4 reasons why Christians are persecuted. We are harmless people. We are not terrorists. We are so calm. We contribute to the community. But why are we persecuted? There are 4 beautiful reasons. There are more Christians added every day. Therefore, the civilizations, the religions, the cultures are threatened. Therefore, they want to apply brake in order to protect their identity. Therefore, Christians are persecuted. Number 2, they are a powerful anti-Christian drive because they do not like Christianity growing faster. They do not like this Christianity because Satan is angry on them. They do not like, his aim is to exactly make the world like the Noah's days. Number 3, sometimes Christians are identified with Western culture and politics. Oh, you are American. You are a Christian, or you are American. And they do not like Americans. They do not like Western culture. They do not like Western thought and its politics. Therefore, you become a scapegoat. You are persecuted. Number 4, final reason. The secular West is not defending or protecting the Christianity anymore. They themselves are becoming more materialistic. They themselves are becoming more secular. Therefore, they do not heed to the principles of the Bible. I know on their dollar it is written, "In God we trust." I know they believe in the Bible. I know they so-called the Europe or America or Australia, they are known as Christian countries, but they do not openly no more defend Christian. In fact, from their constitution, they're trying to remove the Ten Commandments. They're trying to remove the moral ethics. The world is becoming more selfish, more secular, more materialistic. As a result, the spiritual Christianity is diminishing, and therefore Christians are left helpless. Christians are left helpless. In the book, In the Lion's Den, written by Nain Ashia, writes, anti-Christian propaganda and the persecution in the recent times is because of the two political ideologies. I repeat once again, in the book, In the Lion's Den, Nain Ashia says, the anti-Christian propaganda, well-organized way, it is persecution in recent times, it's because of two political ideologies, communism and militant Islam. Because of this, many Christians are targeted so that they would gain popularity. They will be well-recognized and they will grow popular. How about Adventists and persecutions? Adventists, are we persecuted? Perhaps we are not. Because we are a smaller group. We are just 100 years old. We are a smaller denomination. And people do not really pay attention to the smaller denomination. We are not pure, therefore Satan is not really angry on us. We compromise in our standards. We do not really hold on to our truths at times, therefore Satan is not really angry. We are lukewarm. Therefore Satan has not much work with us, therefore he doesn't bother about us. Number three, we are not persecuted, we are not involved in politics, open politics. Very few Adventists are openly. Maybe recent days, Ben Carson, maybe they are trying to get in, but still they are criticized and all for their principles and all. We are not persecuted, we are not targeted by the major groups around the world because we do not use violence. We do not believe in holding a gun, killing people and all. Islam particularly is kind to us. Islamic religion is little understanding to us because of our beliefs. We are the people of the book. That's why Islam do not openly. If they know that we are people of the book, the Quran clearly tells us, if you do not understand the principles of Allah and the Quran, go and learn from the people of the book. Therefore, they do not usually come to us. And therefore, we keep the Sabbath, and the Quran supports the Sabbath. We believe in the second coming of Christ. The Quran talks about the second coming of Christ. Another reason why Islamic world supports Adventist church is because of our lifestyle. We do not believe in idols. We do not eat pork. We do not chew tobacco or drink alcohol. Our lifestyle attracts them. Therefore, Adventists are spared. If a matured, genuine Islamic man try to become friendly to an Adventist, we are special in the sight of the Lord. We are the remnant. We have the special message in the last days. But Satan one day will cough at us, will target us, will try to destroy us. This evening, the target of my message is, how strong is our faith? If today something has to happen to us, if you have to be coming out of our comfort zone, if you are disturbed and if our faith is tested, will we stand our ground? Will we stand our principles? Will we give away? Christianity in many parts today has become a business, a namesake thing. There is very little genuine Christianity in so-called Christianity. We are so-called Christians because we have the personal relationship with Jesus, our Lord. We have the personal relationship knowing His, understanding His word. This is the standard. This is the base. This is our platform to function on. We are people of the book, the Sola Scriptura. Early church was persecuted. In the great controversy, there are three segments of persecution. If you understand the whole picture of great controversy, 6,000 years plus 1,000 years, there are three main segments of persecution. Number one, persecution in the early church. Out of the 12 disciples, you remember, 11 of them were just killed, martyred. One of them, the emperor was so angry, he boiled the oil and put him in, the youngest of the disciple, the 18-year-old John. But the Lord removed the physical properties from that heated oil, and he was not able to kill him. Therefore, he threw him away beyond the seas onto the Patmos Islands. So the first century persecutions, especially by Nero, Diocletian, Domitian, and many others. If you want to read one or two examples of it, you can read the book of Acts. So colorful, the story of the early church. So many activities, so many sacrifices, the deliberate leading of God, God's power exhibited, organizing of the church and spreading of the gospel just in the midst of persecutions. One side the Jewish community, one side the Roman community, trying to destroy this small little sect called Christians. The second part of Christian persecution came during the 16 years of Dark Ages, the Papal Rome. Pagan Rome was over, Christianity entered into the church, the strategy of Satan, compromising, keeping away the truth and compromising the principles of the Bible. The idols came in, the priestly systems came in, the heathenism came in, the heathen practices came in, the Greco-Roman mindset has come in, the world has come into the world. As a result, for 1600 years, this beautiful scripture, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path," it was so removed away, and therefore it is called the Dark Age. 1600 years. During these 1600 years, you heard about in history the Albigenses, the Waldenses, the stories, the heroic faith, how they could protect themselves, how they were adjusting, how they were praying, how they are protecting their scriptures, how they are united in prayer, pleading with the Lord. They held up the torch of the scriptures. Exactly 500 years ago and 1 year, 501 year ago, Martin Luther nailed the thesis and said, "Back to sola scriptura." Out of the Dark Ages, into the modern age of Reformation, into the scriptures, into the prayer life, into the personal relationship with my God, my Savior, who can save me at the end. Number three, Christian persecution, three segments. One was the early church, the first centuries. Second one was the Dark Ages. Third one is the end of time. Can you please come with me to Daniel 12th chapter? It is explained there for us so clearly. God never tells or punishes any time without informing us. I am reading Daniel 12th chapter, the last chapter of the little book that is so sweet in the mouth and became bitter in the stomach. You read the Revelation 10th chapter, close connection with it. From there born the Adventist church. Okay, we see 12th chapter here, verse 1. "At that time, in the final days, in the latter rain, when the sealing is taking place, when the shaking is taking place, when the mark of the beast exhibits its power, when the church is persecuted, when people are left, the minority, the truth-filled people, the followers of Christ, where at that time when they are persecuted, Michael shall stand up." Wow. Michael, Jesus Christ, will stand up on our behalf. "The great prince standeth for the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation." I'm a little worried about the later one. "There will be time of trouble such as there was never on this earth." Brothers and sisters, dear young people, we are every day when we pray, the last phrase usually is, "Lord, when thou come in the clouds of heaven, remember me. Take us into your heavenly home. Give us the salvation." But then before getting that salvation, we must be purified. We must be tested individually and as a church. We must go through a process of testing. And when the time of trouble comes, when our faith is tested, I'm asking, individual of your Christian faith, will you stand? So many of the young people, they talk, few stand for the Sabbath, but many give away. Few stand for the principles of health, but some give away. Few do not understand the real truth. This evening, my burden is that if we will understand, we are living in difficult days. We are living in really challenging days. Satan is almost capturing the whole earth, including India. Hinduism is revived. There is restriction from every angle for spread of the true religion, the living God, and the salvation that we have. Will you be willing to stand for the truth? Will you be willing to share the end time? On your side, you are not alone. Michael will stand and fight on your behalf. At his command, there are thousands of angels. At our request, there is a fulfillment of God's promise of protection. He will be with us even to the end of the earth. He loves his saints. He knows what we are. He knows where we need help. He is on our side. He will fight our battle, provided we stand for the faith and say, Lord, I am for you. I will speak, I will stand, I will practice, I will propagate, I will be for you, O Lord Jesus, in the end time. Because you are selected to be the part of the remnant church, the end time church. We are here to share the message of Lord Jesus Christ. Let's review back a little more, if you don't mind, just a few more minutes. The New Testament teaching of suffering. Why suffering is important? Is it part? So many Hindus, so many other people said, if you believe your God is so powerful, if you believe your God has created the universe with his word spoken out, if you believe your God is capable of turning the wine into water into wine or many other wonderful things, how is that Christians still suffer? We cannot answer such question with yes or no. There is a different way of explaining such an answer. There is no shortcut answer for it. Through suffering, we are refined. Through suffering, we do not show that our carnal nature is important, not our body life is important, but we give importance to our spiritual growth. We get connected to the heavenly God. Our spiritual things must be spiritually discerned. When we are willing to give up the worldliness, we grow spiritually strong. With the stoning of Stephen, scattered the believers. In the New Testament, believers are connected with Christ's suffering and faithful witnessing. We must also do the same, being the last day church, because we receive the latter rain, this suffering of Christ with faithful witnessing. Early Christians regarded Christ's death as martyrdom, and they're willing to have the part in his suffering and in death. Book of Acts is so strong in the story and witnessing. He says, the true Christianity is exhibited when you are daring to stand, willing to suffer, willing to come forth in spite of difficulties and threats in your life. Paul calls the young disciples to be faithful witness, martyrs for Jesus. In 1 Timothy 6:12 and 13, he says, you can suffer for Christ, you will rejoice with the Christ. If you are willing to give up your opinions, your pleasures, if you are willing to suffer, God will exalt you in due time. Timothy was martyred in 97 AD after he courageously denounced the worship of goddess of Ephesus. Therefore, Timothy, the trained one, was like Paul, died like Paul for Jesus Christ. What is the deeper meaning of martyrdom and persecution? Many Christians do not understand the suffering. It is cruel, unjust, and can't understand why God is allowing suffering for us. I am a Christian, but why should I suffer? John 10:10 says, Jesus came to give life and in its fullness. Other translation, it says, in its abundance. whenever I enter into the division office, the main entrance door, I like the copper plate that is portrayed there. I asked Pastor Cooper, what made you to do put this picture here and the beautiful quotation down? He said, for India, that is the best. Jesus came, took thee through avatar of man to give you life, not ordinarily, but in abundance. I love that scripture. If he has come to give life in abundance, why Christians are expected to suffer, to be persecuted? Because there are good reasons. God has a purpose in everything. I'm reading a small sentence from Desire of Ages, page 224. It says, God never leads his children otherwise than they would choose to be led. He won't force us. He's a loving God. He will not compel us. He honors our request. He respects our will and desires. But at the same time, God never leads his children otherwise than they would choose to be led. If they could see the end from the beginning and discern the glory. What is he telling in the second part of the sentence? He's telling, if we could see what is going to happen, if we could comprehend the glories we are going to enjoy, if we could understand the full plan and the perfect plan of the mighty God, wow, that will be great picture. It is today's world is an instant world. I want instantly everything. Right now, I want. We cannot wait. We cannot suffer. We cannot work hard. People like to have first the crown. Later on, we will see the cross. But in Christianity, it is always, even in the English dictionary, if you see, first the cross, then the crown. Jesus suffered for us and died for us, then the crown. He wore the thorny crown so that in exchange, we will be able to give us the crown of glory. Beautiful concept in the scriptures. Do not look for the crown of glory now. First the cross, willing to suffer. Willing to give up your rights, willing to be a witness. Don't be ashamed to stand for Jesus. The cross, the crown, and the glory. Beautiful. That is the pattern of Jesus Christ. Paul said in 2 Timothy 3:12, all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. May I repeat that golden statement? I underlined it with red ink in my cell. Lord, help me to stand when I have to be tested. I wrote in my Bible, Lord, help me to stand when this scripture fulfills in my personal Christian life, that I will not dilute, that I will not deny, that I will not go away, but I will stand for Jesus. It says, all that will be living godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Paul saw martyrdom as a participation in Christ's suffering and for the benefit of the church. You don't live for yourself. Live for the benefit of the church. I rejoice in my suffering. Colossians 1:24. I rejoice. He says, I take pride. I rejoice in my suffering. God never leave us nor forsake us. In difficult times, he will be with us. Talk about Acts 16th chapter. They were beaten for no reason. They were persecuted. And then they were put in the jail. Did the Lord keep quiet? No. He came in the middle of the night. He shook the earth. He removed their chains and said, get out of here. Go join the church. God will take care of you. As I close, I want to tell few benefits of becoming a martyr or willing to suffer for Christ's sake. Number one, New Testament believers need to know that they have eternal life because of suffering. It is the witness of the Spirit. The reality of fight of faith is willing to suffer. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad. Great is your reward, says Matthew 5:12. Be faithful unto death, for I will give you the crown of life, says the last book of the Bible, Revelation 2:10. What more we need? There are greater rewards waiting. If you suffer for 10 paisa, God is willing to give you 100 rupees. Call to be true Christian. There is a high reward for you. Number two, the benefits of willing to suffer for the Lord's sake. Number two, martyrdom leads to growth. Martyrdom leads to new conversions. The blood of the Christian is the seed for the church to grow, wrote the Tertullian, the early Christian apologist. He wrote, as soon as the persecutions are there, the church spread around. And everywhere there began to grow Christian people, Christian churches. So when we suffer, when we are willing to give up ourselves for the sake of Christ and the gospel, the church and the gospel spreads around. How true, in the death of the Christian martyr, Jesus is lifted up. People are drawn to him. Persecutions results in scattering the witnesses. Gospel is shown widely. Beginning with apostles, we say remarkable conversions, powerful teachings and preachings, there are always new congregations established. Number three, the benefits of persecutions. I know you are getting a little tired, but in few minutes I will close. Persecutions purifies the church. Are we pure? I'm not sure. Yes, once in 12 weeks we come to the Lord's table, we ask for forgiveness, we reconcile ourselves. There is little more than that. There is much more than that. Perfection is our goal. Godliness and godlikeness is the goal to be reached. Our standards are not compared with the church leaders. Our standards are not compared with the pastor. Our standards are compared with Jesus Christ, our Lord. Persecutions purifies the church by winnowing out false-hearted, half-hearted, hypocritical mindset. All will be purified, says Ellen White in Great Controversy 602. Number four, persecutions unifies the church. In our church, there are divisions, language divisions, caste divisions, educated, uneducated classifications. We are rich and poor. There is pride and arrogance between us. We do not like our neighbor. There are challenges between us. But when the persecution comes, church is benefited so much. Persecutions unified the church. The reflection action of shaking and shifting and purifying the church. The faithful will be remained. The chaff will be thrown away. And many more will join the church. Nearer we come to the Lord, the brighter we see his face. The purer we become, we reflect and bring glory to the Lord Jesus, our Maker. Wow! There will not be any difference. We become like the first early church. We become so united. Number five, the benefits of suffering for the sake of Christ. Endurance in the midst of persecution, it gives us strength. It gives us strength, and we grow in faith. We reflect the character of God. Persecution strengthens the weak believers among us. When they see our testimony, when they see our power, when they see our standing for Christ, they will also follow us. Because not all are same. Not all are same. I have many examples, but because of the time, I'm cutting down. Persecutions, because of suffering, how are we benefited? Number six, through trials and persecutions, we glorify God, and the character of God is revealed in the chosen ones. Acts of the Apostles 5:76. Through the persecutions, we glorify God. That is the purpose we are created. Angels were created for that purpose. God in his great wisdom created us to glorify him. So in the persecutions, in the trials, in the suffering, we glorify God and we reveal the character of God at the chosen ones. And heaven rejoices for the investment they made on our behalf, for 24 hours protection of the angels, for the working of the Holy Spirit, for the God and his suffering and his he coming down to lift us up, all of us. Number seven, in the death of the faithful witness is the death of Satan. Oh, how is that connected? When a righteous person is suffering and his weeping goes up to heaven, Satan is put to shame. The unfallen world understands us and the Satan is put to shame. For example, in the book of Job, you know it. They were having perhaps workers' meeting, and early morning, maybe at the breakfast table, Jesus was visiting and greeting everyone, and suddenly he saw an ordinary, very impolite person there. "Hey, where are you come? Where have you come from?" And the devil, the evil one, the one who captured, stolen Adam's position, he said, "From running to and fro, walking to and fro from the earth, I have come." "Oh, is that so? Then if you have come from there, I have some of my representatives there. Have you heard of my son Job?" And Satan sighs back and said, "Yeah, of course, I know. But your hand is around him. You are protecting him. You blessed him. You kept him above. That's why he's representing. Actually, the whole world is mine." There is accusation on all of us. But when we are willing to suffer persecution, when we stand for the truth, Satan is silenced. Satan is put to shame. Therefore, our target is to defeat the Satan. This evening, how strong is our faith? How pure is our Christianity? How strong is our relationship with Jesus Christ? I read a small illustration, a true story, a small illustration. In the time of Roman Empire, there is one man, emperor, who wants to know if his garrison, if his army of soldiers are faithful to him or not. He wants to know how true they are. Someone reported in the 47th group of the army of 40 soldiers, there are some Christians who do not like to worship you as a king, as the Lord, as God, O King. And he sent a word, sent one of his best soldier to them and said, they are in that one particular area. They are responsible for protecting that Roman territory there. Kindly go check. And this general went there to find those 40 soldiers faithful in their duty. And to test their faith, they are with the Roman emperor, willing to worship him as God or not. He told them, "Come on, tell me how many of you will be able to offer your incense. I'm putting the emperor's picture here. I have little incense here, the smoke here, the fire here. If you are willing to worship the emperor, please put the incense there." And the 40 soldiers said no. They were not willing to give. Finally, the general threatened them, "If you do not want to offer an incense to the emperor and accept him as your God and king, then you will be stripped. Your dress will be removed. It is a coldest month of the, and therefore it is deep in the cold desert. You will have to suffer. You will die." They kept quiet. They did not say anything. They did not retaliate. They did not form a group to kill this general. No. They kept praying, "Lord, strengthen our faith." And therefore it was in the middle of the night, the time was over, they were kept and they said, "Now all of you, if you are not willing to obey me, remove all your dress, go to the center of the lake, the cold, icy lake, stand there. You will die tonight." They all went, cuddling together, started singing. As they were singing, slowly the voice began to dim, the slower and slower, the no energy. One person fell down and died. And immediately they began to say, 39 strong soldiers for the Lord, 39 strong soldiers, we stand for the Master, we love our God. One of them immediately ran away from there to the hot place where there's fire to warm himself. 28 for the Lord. But watching all those things, the general was so converted. He removed his dress. "No, it's not 39. It is 40. He went and joined himself and, "I see your faith. I see your Master. I see your Lord. I see your character. I see the obedience to the Lord." And he went and joined. Next day, the king's army comes and try to understand what was happening. In that bundle of group, they was removing and trying to load so they can bury them. In the middle was the general that was deputed to kill them. He was there. And the king asked, "What is he doing there?" "Oh, sir, last night he was one of them, joined to be a Christian." This evening, as you spend this Sabbath, let's be reminded we are living in the last days. It's my plea, at any cost, we will not jeopardize our salvation. We will not take risk. We will not compromise. We will not give up. Strong, standing strong, daring like Daniel. Today, if our wealth is removed, don't worry. Today, if our jobs are removed, don't worry. Today, if someone denies us of our comforts, don't worry. Willing to suffer and stand for the Lord. Today and soon, our faith will be tested. Dear young people, dear brothers and sisters, dear church in Hosur, dear colporters, dear visitors, this evening, I plead that our faith will be strong and pure. It will be firm like Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The Lord is willing to help you. The Lord is willing to stand by your side if you will accept Him as your personal Savior. When the troubles come, we will be united. We will stand firm for the Lord. At the end, when the Lord shall come, you have fought a good fight. You stood your faith, and there is a great reward waiting for each one of us. God bless us.